This is Duke University.
As I was preparing to lead a group of human rights researchers in Jordan about 2 years ago this month, or last month, we met with a high-ranking UN, well, UNESCO official, saying, we were going to go to this vast Za'atari refugee camp in northern Jordan, which at that point had surpassed 100,000 people. And we said, we're going to talk to Syrian university students there. And she just sort of threw her hand up and scoffed and said, there are no university students in Za'atari. And it really brings up this idea that in international humanitarian work, especially around refugees, there's sometimes a disconnect between the lived reality of the refugee and refugee lives, the diversity of refugees, the class diversity of refugees, the needs of refugees, the skills of refugees, and what international humanitarian and aid organizations think of refugees. And this is a UN official who probably should have known better, but she had reduced the refugees to a single category and thought, all those refugees in Za'atari come from the area around Deraa, which is one of these kind of dusty cities in southern Syria. Most cities in Syria are pretty dusty, but even more dusty than that, which is a very agricultural area. And why would there be any university students there? That's sort of an elite practice. Now, the reason why I knew that there were refugee university students in Za'atari is because I'd lived in Syria for many years. And I knew young people from Deraa who were going to the University of Damascus. So I assumed that in any refugee population, especially from Syria, there would be. And we know from some pre-war statistics, which are shaky at best, that about 18% of the Syrian population between the ages of 16 and 24 go to some kind of post-secondary training, go to university of some kind. More city people go to university than people from the countryside, but it evens out to about 18%. So that's a tremendously large number. The other thing we learned, too, is that the UN doesn't count. I thought I would just bring this up. I can zoom in some. The UN doesn't count people on the basis of that kind of age. I'll just pause for a moment with this chart, because I think this is an important chart to think about. This is from yesterday, or today, actually. This is almost a 4 million total number of concerned Syrian refugees right now, right? And this is a very good chart down below here, which shows the almost exponential growth of the Syrian refugee population registering with the UN. There was a small dip here in January, which is attributable to intense fighting at many of the border crossing areas, but as soon as that subsided, there was a tremendous leap just in January of this year. One of the things that frustrated us going into this project about refugee university students was that if you look at the way the United Nations counts people, and this gives you a sense of how the sort of bureaucratic approaches to refugee lives can be a problem, they count kids up to 17, they demarcate it, and then there's this big population, 18 to 59. How many of you are here are closer to 18 than 59? All of you guys, right? I hope. Are the needs of an 18-year-old the same as the needs of a 59-year-old? Not a lot, right? So making this one big group is deeply problematic and is really based probably on UN refugee planning from an earlier period where you didn't have as much, maybe not as much diversity in refugee populations. And then you have old people, I think personally, 60 plus down here at the bottom. But this is just a terrifying number to me. You know, the 4 million mark with about the same 4 to 5 million internally displaced in Syria, that's like 10 million people. So most of them, of course, are in Lebanon, Turkey, and Jordan. I'll be talking about that in a second. Is there any questions about this chart before I move on? This is from the UNHCR. This is updated periodically, and this is from today.
What's the starting point down at the bottom of the far left?
This is March 11, and so this is January, and this is today. So I've been very interested in the, let's see if my Prezi goes the right way. very interested in the history of refugees, and this is part of my book, in part because refugees I see as the definitive modern person, because they challenge our received notions of shared humanity, of dignity, and human rights. They're a challenge to all of these ideas that are so much part of the modern world, and they destabilize them. And so now that I finished my second book, I'm going to be working on my third book, which is a retelling of the history of the modern Middle East from the perspective of refugees. And Don has written a very similar and interesting and good book on that topic as well, where the refugee is this continuing presence in the history of the Middle East, at least from the latter part of the 19th century through today. And we can really rethink the history of the region in that process. This is a photograph from the Harvard Fine Arts Library, and I put it in here because, for several reasons, what can you tell me about these tents? Anything?
Is that open underneath, or is
No. They've got a like a canvas bottom, dark canvas bottom. What do you tell me about them?
These are army tents.
These are First World War army tents, and they're all laid out in straight lines. Anyone know what this is? This is one of the first refugees camp. It was called that. During the First World War, these are the Armenians from the village of Musada, who about 100 years ago, at the outset of the Armenian genocide, resisted the order to be deported and survived, only by being rescued by a French and British ship, where they were brought to this sort of deserty area near Port Said in Egypt. And the tents were laid out in military ranks. There was barbed wire around the fences. Exit and entrance was controlled by the military. These are the men of Musada being marched out, and boys being marched out in the morning to go work somewhere to help provide for themselves. And then the women and children stayed back in tents. There was the Armenian Red Cross had established schools and hospitals and so on. But this is very much the first refugee camp. In form and function, it is no different from Zaatari, 100 years later. Those of you who know my wife, this is her village. That's why she survived. I mean, that's why she exists, because these guys survived. So here's my book. I can give you a discount. you guys will appreciate it. This is the soup kitchen at Alay during the First World War. The faculty of the American University in Beirut took it upon themselves to feed this was the year of the locust, and also when Ottoman requisitioning and the Allied naval blockade was starving Lebanon and the great Syrian famine. And so these are photos from the various soup kitchens. And these pictures come from the AUB archive.
Bread from Stones
is a, in Turkish and Armenian and Arabic, it's just an ancient phrase. It's like Kadın Hatsanel in Armenian and Turkish, Taştan Ekmeğe Çıkarmış. It just means something, people who are in desperate conditions work so hard they can pull bread out of a piece of stone. And actually, it occurs in the Bible when Jesus goes out in the desert. The devil comes to him and says, if you're the Son of God, make these stones become bread. So it may come from that too. But I think it's even older than that. It's a great, and Arabic has one, and even Mahmoud Darwish in a poem makes reference to bread, taking things from stone, bread from stone. So, back to Jordan and the project. I had developed a relationship between the UC Davis Human Rights Initiative and the Institute of International Education, which is sort of one of the premier, many of you done Fulbright and so on. It helps administer that. But they also run the Scholar Rescue Fund alongside the Scholars at Risk, have been responsible for helping place rescued scholars around the world. And they became very interested in what was happening to Syrian scholars who had taken refuge in Jordan. And I was very interested in refugee university students, and so we combined forces for a visit to Jordan in March of 2013. I was there as part of a working group with the Overseas Development Institute for writing the history of humanitarianism, and I got to spend lots of quality time with Prince Hassan of Jordan in the process. It's kind of a joke. So yeah, so we one beautiful morning, we went out to the Za'atari refugee camp, and we saw this is the typical photograph of refugees, right? You've got the barbed wire. This is the registration facility for the International Organization of Migration, the IOM. Faceless, shapeless people with their luggage sort of reduced to what they could carry. And, you know, we weren't looking for your students there, but instead we found a lot of them. We found dozens and dozens of refugee university students in Za'atari, and we found lots of women refugee university students. We'd done a parallel project in Amman where we'd met university students as well. But this is one of the focus groups that we had. This is my colleague on the left. To my right is Adrian Fricke, who is now the field director for Physicians for Human Rights in Syria and has been training refugee Syrian doctors and nurses to document torture. And on my left is Tara Siegel, a public policy student at Georgetown University. And these are a group of young women, mostly from the Damascus University branch campus in Deraa, but also the main campus of Damascus University in Damascus. And they met with us in this big circus tent that was set up in the Za'atari camp. And many of them were young women who had finished degrees in STEM fields. And we're looking to try to finish. And we began to, just talking with them, we began to learn a lot about their concerns, and especially the value that they were putting on higher education as a way to delay marriage and family formation, but also as a way for them to help provide for their families. And almost all of them had said that they knew of other young women who had been pressured, is probably the least problematic way of saying it, into forms of early marriage. And there, are stories of men walking through the Za'atari camp, visiting tents and asking random families if they could marry their daughters. Young refugee women especially make very good second wives because they're in such desperate situations. But they've talked about problems that I'll focus on towards the end of the talk in terms of sort of solution areas that had to do primarily with documentation and with being able to access and just learn about educational opportunities. So this led to the first of a series of reports. I wanted to put the refugee students on the front, but my art historian wife said, no, you have to stay with the stereotypical image. So we kept that one. And this report, I think, really began the process of calling attention to some of these issues. It helped to shape especially some of the policy directives of the European Union, and I think helped contribute to a major initiative by the president of Portugal to bring not hundreds, but dozens of Syrian university students to Portugal to study. The project then continued in Beirut. Now, of course, Lebanon is home to over 1 million Syrian refugees, migrants, people who transit back and forth. I mean, the border has been fluid, and it's increasingly becoming more difficult, especially for men to cross the border between Lebanon and Syria. Now, of course, this means that something like 1 in 4 or 1 in 3 human beings in the territory of Lebanon is a Syrian refugee, which is a remarkable number if you think about it. And in Lebanon, of course, there were all sorts of different problems. In Jordan, Syrian refugees were viewed by the Jordanian population as a nuisance, but I don't think they were hated. In Lebanon, the Syrian refugees tended to be hated by many of the Lebanese that we encountered. A kind of deep hatred that I was unprepared for, even amongst some of Lebanon's most educated people. Now, we attribute this hatred to all sorts of factors, including history, the history of the Syrian occupation of Lebanon, but also just this generalized Lebanese uncertainty about the future, that Syrians were disrupting it. And also, they were driving down wages. In many cases, they were very well educated and were able to take very, very technically sophisticated jobs for very little money, displacing Lebanese professionals and so on. So this is a group of Kurdish students from all over Syria who had congregated at a makeshift refugee school in downtown Beirut at Maqasid, sort of on the southern side of town towards the airport. And, you know, they were talking a lot about how they could find work, and they were working sometimes 12 to 14 hours a day, trying to go to school and not having any time to sleep or sleeping during class, which, you know, my undergraduates will do, but they have no excuse. But these young people certainly did. But they were working jobs as painters, as nannies, as seamstresses, selling telephones in shopping malls, all sorts of pickup jobs where, especially as college students, their soft skills were very useful. But they all seemed to be suffering terribly from this sort of burdens of family, burdens of schooling, and just life in Lebanon. And the daily interaction with the Lebanese was also grinding on them, right? And their generalized fear of the fact that the Syrian security forces seemed to be able to operate at will within Lebanon, which was especially important to students who might have had an activist past, some of whom we encountered at the AUB campus, who had really felt that they were endangered there at Ras Beirut in ways that they felt the American University wasn't protecting them. This led then to the second of our reports. We got money from the Carnegie Corporation, so the quality of the presentations were better. The war follows them. I'll talk more about some of the specific findings in a second. But that was one of these ideas that we brought with us from our work in Lebanon, is that the young Syrians in Lebanon did not feel as though the conflict was something they had escaped, that it was ever present with them, that Lebanon was so close to Syria that it was so unstable that the kind of relief that they had sought in Lebanon wasn't really with them, and the war had come with them across the border, and it was being replayed in their daily interactions with the people in the country. This is just a chart to illustrate, though, one of the other problems, which is that starting on the left, this is Syrians enrolled in the Lebanese University. So Lebanese University is the big state school in Lebanon. Lebanon has a very interesting, unique to Lebanon, higher education system, where very few of the faculties teach in Arabic, but rather in French or English, which has meant that for Lebanese, their ability to have these incredibly, you know, be very mobile in terms of their career paths and choices has been very important. Many of the Syrians, of course, in Syria, there's, until very recently, foreign language education has been terrible. And so Syrians might have tremendously good Arabic, which is why it was great to live in Syria, because you could really work on your Arabic. We like to send our students there, but no one spoke English, so that was the trade-off. They come into Lebanon, where if they want to study in certain faculties, with some exceptions like Islamic religion and so on, they have to do so in foreign languages. But nevertheless, Syrians were eligible to attend Lebanese University as part of an exchange agreement between Damascus University and Lebanese University. And you can see from this chart that before the war, Lebanese and Syrian enrollment was very high. But ever since the war began in Syria, you would anticipate it be the other way, that Syrian enrollment should be increasing in Lebanese University as Syrians are coming across the border. But instead, we found out is that Lebanese University had begun to actively discriminate against Syrian admission. And this was true for many other universities in Lebanon, with some of the exception of the more sectarianized universities like Balamand, which were increasing their enrollment of Greek Orthodox students, and Haigazian University, which was making great strides to try to find places for Assyrian Armenian refugees, primarily from Aleppo, to continue to go to school. So we noticed that the opposite of what you would expect was happening in Lebanon, that the enrollment of Syrians in Lebanese universities was decreasing rather than increasing as a function of the war. We then next set of project was about less than a year ago, this last June and July, in the southern tier of Turkey, including bold research in Istanbul and centering on the great city of Gaziantep, which is really where the center of many Syrians have moved there. They found work there. And we did not in our visit, well, back up for a second. First, in Lebanon, there are no refugee camps for Syrians. The Lebanese government, all this policy keeps on being debated, has not allowed the UNHCR to establish formal camps. In Turkey, there are refugee camps, but in Turkey, there are no refugees because the Turkish government refuses to call them refugees. Rather, they're called guests. In part, this is out of a kind of sense of Muslim solidarity, but also it's because Turkey does not want to apply the 1951 Refugee Convention to any other Middle Eastern peoples. Turkey has signed the 1951 Refugee Convention, but only applies it to people of European origin. So Syrians, for all intents and purposes, receive the same kind of assistance they would otherwise as refugees, but they're not called refugees, but rather misafir. So this is an Aintep in this old walled house. I liked Aintep because it reminded me of Aleppo. This is what I really liked about it. And so we're meeting with a group of students, some of whom were at Zivre University and others who had enrolled at Aintep University. I'll call your attention to the young woman on the lower right in the headscarf. She was a neurobiology major from Aleppo who fled with her family one night with nothing else. And she had very good English. And so she went to the University of Gaziantep, where many of the faculties are supposed to be in English. It's like an MIT-style university, very, very little in terms of humanities, mostly in terms of STEM fields. And so it's supposed to be taught mostly in English. But what happens is, if you only have Turkish students enrolled in these classes, and you have Turkish professors, people just speak Turkish with each other. So many of the professors really like having these Syrian students in the classes because, first off, their English tends to be better, but you have to speak English in order to do it. So she went in as a special auditor, worked extremely hard, sort of that, you know, these Aleppans, I lived with Aleppans for a long time. They're incredibly hardworking, entrepreneurial people. And so she made herself indispensable to this class. She gave lectures and then was given a full ride scholarship. And I have to tell you, I was so proud of her. I was just like, this is great. And she's doing very well, except they're all, I mean, one of the things I remember sitting with these young people is, with the exception of her, the boys all went through at least 2 packs of cigarettes while they were sitting with us. And they're drinking a lot, they're smoking a lot. She had all sorts of facial tics, and many of the Syrian young people I met have these facial tics that seem to be a sign of tremendous stress. And as you know, you know this from your undergraduates, right? They get into this stressful, you can see it on their faces and you can read it in their bodies. You guys don't know that about us, but we can. We know these things. So this was a great visit, and we're able to learn a great deal about Turkish higher education, which I will not bore you with, except the fact that there's a very limited number of seats that are available for Syrians. So even though Turkey has this massive higher education sector, it already isn't big enough to serve the Turks themselves. And so many Turks who are considered eligible to attend higher education in Turkey don't get the seats that are reserved. So this causes some stress. Although on the other hand, the Turkish state has exempted Syrians from competing against, say, students from Africa or Asia for the foreign student positions. And you know, I have to say that Turkey really had a very humane attitude towards especially these Syrian young people. And I think it's part of a larger political project where Turkey is anticipating absorbing large numbers of Syrians and some form of giving them some form of Turkish citizenship, because Turkey is a democracy, likes to create new voters. So the analogy would be the Irish in 19th century New York and Boston politics. As they would come to America, they would be then given citizenship by the Democrat Party machine and then vote Democrat for the next 100 years. And I think that's what many in Turkey are anticipating. The one very important finding, this is our, that's the front of the young woman in the headscarf. I was, you know, you just get so moved by the resilience of some of these young people. You just want to try to do anything you can for them. But one of the things we discovered, because we had good we intuit that this is also the case in Jordan and in Lebanon, but we had to intuit that idea. But in Turkey, we have good numbers from the Turkish Ministry of Higher Education, and it looks like, well, 20 to 80, right? Whereas we know from pre-war figures in Syria that male-female attendance at higher education in Syria was roughly 50-50. So it's kind of, I mean, you know, in the United States right now, it's like 60-40, women outnumbering men. In Syria, it was roughly even. So there's also, I mean, let me just pose to you, why do you think this number is this way? Anyone, you've been studying refugees. Why are more young men going to school than young women? Even though it should be, yes, Don?
I give you a theory. I don't think it is proved yet, but you know, we talk about early marriage a lot about young women, but we forget that a lot of men have had to delay marriages because they can't afford it. They're in a situation where they can't, and so a lot of the men will continue in education if they possibly can.
Right.
The young women are entering into arranged marriages early.
Right. Anecdotally, when we would talk to women who were from families where you had boys, young men, and young women, they would say that their family said, "We have the resources for one of you. We're going to send the boy. When you, the girl, needs to stay here in the household and work here." So that it's where a resource decision is being made. In refugee situations, men tend to be more mobile than women. But we thought this was a terrible development, actually. Because the thing is that was so important about one of the things that was important about higher education in Syria for women was that it did allow them to delay marriage. It allowed them to create careers for themselves and led to female empowerment. And this is even more so important in diaspora. And so we have these hundreds of recommendations, but one of the most important is trying to address this gap. And we were trying to get, one of the things we'd like to try to do, this is like my new project, is to encourage the very elite American-style universities in Turkey, Lebanon, and Egypt to reserve spaces for female undergraduates. So this would be places like Boğaziçi University in Turkey, or AUB in Beirut, or the American University in Cairo. Right. So, but a couple of final notes. I know I'm getting close on time. So I'm sitting with one of my favorite people, a man named Ahmad Ibrahim, who's the former dean of the veterinary school at Aleppo University. Another one of these people who, you know, got a phone call in the middle of the night that said, "Leave town." And we're sitting there in Reyhanlı, which is that's a real dusty town. And we're just sitting out on the porch, and we met with a group of young men and so on. He says, "You know, Keith, if these guys don't go to school, they're going to join the Daesh. They're going to join the Islamic State. They're going to become radicalized." And and you could see that there was tremendous pain in his face when he said this. You know, here's this very secular Syrian educator who works in the sciences, and, you know, is trying to get these young people into school, who knows that if the opportunities are not provided by secular modernity, that someone else is going to be able to provide these young men with an opportunity. And I think he was really sad when he told me this. And he also said, if we don't get the girls back into school, they're all going to get married off to the Gulf. So Ahmad Ibrahim was, I think, a little pessimistic. But this is one of these phrases that just stayed with me and continues to do so. So this is my very complex and completely jumbled up Venn diagram. I'm not a science major, so I haven't made this up, but trying to understand what the different kinds of barriers to higher education by country are. So one of the things, of course, is the problem with tuition and fees. And what I tried to do in this chart is say that the bigger the dot, the more problematic it is. So for example, documents are always a problem. And, you know, it's my advice, I mean, how many of you know where your high school diploma is? You better, because if you're a refugee man, you need your high school diploma. But your transcripts, how would you get your transcripts in a moment's notice? I mean, I don't even know. I think my mom has mine somewhere. So in Jordan and Lebanon in particular, there are problems with lack of documents. The other problem is if Syrians have left Syria for Jordan or Lebanon without proper documentation, they're ineligible for assistance from the Syrian consulate, which, you know, is a double whammy on them. We've been trying to ask, but one of the things we asked was UNHCR to help intervene to try to help them produce some of their documentation. In Jordan, language isn't a problem. Almost all the universities instruct in Arabic and English, which is very useful. In Lebanon, you know, even though it's a member of the Arab League, language discrimination is one of the things that the Lebanese society uses to discriminate against Syrians. They also had this conversation with my cab driver on the way in. I said, you know, he said, oh yeah, we gave the Palestinian citizenship. I'm like, no, you didn't. You did not. Lebanon has created the most elaborate forms of discrimination against refugees of any state I've ever encountered. So for example, to be an accountant or a pharmacist, you have to be a member of the Lebanese syndicate of pharmacists or accountants. Well, you can't be a member of the Lebanese, you know, syndicate unless you're a Lebanese citizen. So this means like Palestinians and others who may go through all this training and so on and become very well educated don't have access to legal professional careers. That doesn't mean they don't work, but they just don't work in an above board fashion. Lebanon for refugees, there is one advantage to Lebanon. The state is so weak that the kinds of discrimination or state-based legal discrimination present in Jordan isn't present in Lebanon. And then in Turkey, of course, language is the biggest issue. But, you know, we were spending time with young Syrians, some of whom now have been in Turkey for 2.5 years. They're all going to school and learning Turkish. And, you know, my colleagues and I would speak Turkish with them, and they had great Turkish. So that with each passing moment, this is less and less of a problem. And this is, for example, why I think a very good policy of the UNHCR is that when young people take refuge in a foreign country, the UN would like them to study in the language of that country rather than create these special schools that only teach in Arabic that are sort of set apart. Because the weight of history suggests that people are displaced, the average displacement time for a refugee globally is about 18 years before either they move on or they go home. So that's an entire generation right there. So now, why should we care? This will be my last thought. Why should we care about refugee Syrian university students? Right? I mean, this is something that when we went to the federal government to ask for assistance on this, they said, you know, we don't have enough money for blankets, let alone helping these young people go to school. That's because this is the intellectual capital of any future Syria. But these are also young people, I think, who in many ways have developed a value system which is antagonistic to things like the IS or the Nusra Front in Syria. They would like to sort of see a more modern, moderate Syria emerge. And I think we need to focus on these young people because as Syrians begin to disperse throughout the world as a consequence of the war, these young people with their higher education, with their soft skills, with their sort of global vision, will be incredibly important in helping their families and their communities resettle and be successful in exile around the world. So I'll end at that and open up to questions. Thank you. Don knows more about them than I do. I don't know that much about the IDP situation. I really don't know. Except I know that over 50% of Syrians have moved at least three or four times since the war began, and something like half or three quarters on some form of food assistance. So, I mean, there's a global collapse, right? So,
I think the number is quite a bit higher. It's
you think it's more than five?
No, it's closer to 9 million internally displaced in Syria, with close to 4 million outside. That's
right.
13. That's more than 50% of the population.
More than 50% of the population.
Of the country, and a lot of international assistance goes through the government to areas where they've been displaced if they're in government-held regions. Although it's been negotiated, they should be able to get assistance to areas held by the rebel.
Yeah, but
they're not having a lot of success.
No.
Aid is not getting into Yarmouk as it should be. That's all been negotiated, even though there are only about 18,000 people left there. But many of those 9 million could cross a border if they wanted to. It's one of the points I was trying to make yesterday. They don't want to leave. There's a fear about leaving and not being able to go back. And that's why that quote, I wish you could have said a little bit more about that, of the woman in Turkey who said, "This is as far as I go," or I'm not quite sure how it
goes. Right, we'll stop here and go no further.
We'll go no further, yeah.
Right. Nadia.
Another quick question. Among the students that you met, are there any initiatives like study groups?
Well, the best one, and I thought about showing it, my favorite one, there's a group of young guys at Aintep University who started a Facebook site called The Students at Aintep University. And they really had this idea, and it was started by a young man who had been an activist in Aleppo. And I write about this extensively in the Go No Further report. So he'd been an activist in Aleppo, young guy, engineering student, who he and his friends during the summer that the countryside around Aleppo had been attacked, a lot of people were moving into the nearer suburbs of Aleppo because their family lived there, and so they were coming from the countryside. And so the Red Cross in Aleppo wasn't doing anything for them, and the state wasn't helping them, and school was out. And so these young men thought, oh, well, let's open up the schools and let the internally displaced people go into the schools. And so they went, and they got these acts, and they opened, I mean, they did something that Syrian government hates, which is showing this sort of civil society initiative. And so it ends up, you know, this then gets them on the wrong side of the Red Crescent, because the Red Crescent was, I think it depends on where you are, but I think the Red Crescent was often being used by the state in order to enforce control. They got on the wrong side. Several of his friends are rounded up and executed or disappeared, and he's the last one. He flees across the border into Lebanon and gets to Saudi Arabia, where some of his family are. And then they move back to Aleppo, and he's like consumed with guilt that he's survived and all his friends are dead. He's like talking to me about this. You know, I can't believe what I did to these guys. I mean, I'm the only one left. And so he started this Facebook site where they have good English, and they have good skills, and they translate documents, and they figure out schedules for people to take tests, and they share information. And they do it very effectively. And it's all self-started and self-generated. And the website has, now they've started, satellite websites for Syrian students at, the university in Ada or the university in Ankara or something like this, right? So it's great. This is my favorite one. And one of the discussions that I had with my group was, well, should we try to get them help, right? And we decided no. They're doing just fine without us, right? And they didn't ask for any help from us, so we're not going to give them any help. Whereas, at the same time, my group met with the Syrian interim government, which was, it was just it was a joke. I mean, it was in this like third floor of an apartment building in Aintep, and they were just consumed by this need that they had to make sure that the students took the right kind of thanawi amma and so on, and it was just, and their reach into Syria was only those areas that were controlled by the FSA, which at that point was 15, 16 miles south of the border of Bab al-Hawa and parts of Idlib, and now that's gone. I don't even know where these guys control anymore. So, what bothered me the most was that the Syrian interim government was not operating to try to make life for Syrians in Turkey easier, but rather the sort of fantasy of return that they were mounting. So, I have strong feelings about that.
Keith, how do logistics work? How do these students motivated and able to study? How do they actually get to Ashraf?
Well, I mean, they learn about how to enroll.
But they live in camps.
Very few of the ones who are living in camps are having a harder time getting into schools. That's the other issue, right? So that it usually you have to live in a town or a city with a university to pull this off. So there's a large number of Syrians now living in neighborhoods of Istanbul, especially this suburb called Esenboğa. And it's actually becoming like a little Damascus, in fact, already. So they're able to use the universities, the large number of universities in Istanbul. The ones in camps are not. And in fact, there's almost no recognizable education taking place in the camps at all. There's the moral hazard argument, right? Which is you don't want to make camp life so good that people don't want to leave it. Oh, they don't have French and good French and English. The Syrians don't have good French and English. So, I mean, even if, you know, so if they're going to Lebanese University, I mean, some of the faculties in Lebanese University are in Arabic, but very few are, actually. If they go to any of these other, you know, schools, you know, like Arab University, which is ironically not in Arabic, right? And AUB, of course, is completely in English. And Saint-Joseph is completely in French. Holy Terre Sainte is all in French. Right? So, one of the things that really concerned me when I was there in terms of elementary education, and Dawn in her report talks about this too, which is that the Lebanese government had set up these special schools for Syrians in the afternoon. So there's second shift schools set up by Syrians, and there's also second shift schools set up by Lebanese government. The ones set up by the Lebanese government don't instruct Syrians in French and English. So they're beginning the discriminatory language practice very early in the process. Because, I mean, you know this in Lebanon. If you don't have good French and English, you don't make it, right? I mean, it's a place where that is the marker of middle class status. Is having good access to foreign languages. And if you don't, then you know you are consigned to some sort of perpetual lower class identity.
It doesn't that more of an economic argument, because it is more of a cost benefit. Foreign language extractions are expensive anyway. So in dealing with refugees, host countries tend to act rationally by providing services that they can afford. One thing I wanted to ask, I think related to your interpretation, your presentation, and thank you, but I didn't just see it, is the role of religion as a fact for mobility. If you are Christian in Syria, you have 90% of going to Europe. Mm-hmm. In France, I think now Christian refugees from Syria can easily act easily. So the same thing also in Lebanon, Christian group may support minority groups in Syria based on their religious affiliation. Mm-hmm. And I have witnessed in Egypt doing mostly how they were supporting pro-Muslim brotherhood groups in Syria. They use those facilities to go south to Sudan or to stay in Egypt and so on. So I think that piece is missing in your presentation.
Well, it's not missing in my other work, but that's okay. I mean, look, the process of Christian out-migration from Syria and Lebanon is a 150-year process, and it's just been accelerated because of the war. So just to give you a sense, Aleppo probably had, before the war started, 150,000 Armenians, right? And descendants of the survivors of the Armenian genocide, right? So of that number, there may be 5,000 families left in the city of Aleppo of Armenian origin. So it's fewer than 30,000. So the community has actually lost its, something we've been thinking about lately is it's lost its integrity. In other words, that the things which allow a community to persist, which include schools, churches, hospitals, but also sort of book publishing and newspapers and social clubs and so on, these things are essentially collapsing. And so it's becoming a kind of ghost city. And also demographically, the people who are remaining are the very old and the infirm and the mentally challenged. So if you can leave, you've left. I mean, all the Armenian families that I lived with in Aleppo, there's like one person left in Aleppo, right? And I think the same is true for other parts of Syria. Now, you have to give credence to the fact that in parts of the Syrian Jazeera, non-Muslims are facing genocide. So there's no reason for them to stay, right? True for northern Iraq as well. But I think that a lot of the process you're talking about 90% going on to Europe, I'd like to see that in writing, but I suspect you're right. A lot of that has to do with family unification. A lot of that has to do with sponsorship and so on. But also has prejudice, you know, in favor of non-Muslims. And their sense is that non-Muslims can integrate better into Western society, especially if they're Catholic or something like this. So I want to caution you to think that this is not just something that's caused by the war. This is something that's been happening for a very long time. And so within a generation, the kind of diversity that was very special in Syria will be gone, will be entirely gone, actually. And it'll be replaced by something much more difficult, I think, for everyone.
Keith, let me ask you a pedagogical question. You said at the very beginning of your talk that one of the skill sets you have is teaching undergraduates. So actually, I'd like to know how you inspire undergraduates to do this work. It doesn't sound like it's the best outcome of their undergraduate education if I'm a parent.
No, I think Syrian parents want their kids to go to...
No, I'm talking about the back in Davis. I assume you teach students in Davis about...
Well, yeah, they like it. I mean, my human rights classes are my most full classes. I mean, I teach.
Forget the parents.
Who cares about parents? No, I mean, my human rights class, I mean, we see terrible declining enrollments across the board in humanities and social sciences, right? Especially Davis, which has become a real techie campus. But our human rights classes, I mean, I don't get it. Like, I teach on my genocide class. It fills in an hour. Like, and my wife says, why do these kids want to take genocide? It's a downer, right? But we have hundreds of students every year teach these human rights classes. And I think what's been very rewarding to me is I've been able to bring my colleagues, like Adrienne, the woman who works for PHR now, who was a Syrian Fulbrighter when we were all there too, actually. I don't know if you may not remember her at all, but kind of. So, I mean, I brought her and I thought it was great because almost all my undergraduates are women too. And so, you know, it's nice to have a female role model because they all want to grow up to be like her, right? Which is great. No, I'm not kidding. I mean, these human rights classes are 90% female at this point. And the guys all sit together in these little packs. they tremble. They're like all like sitting together. I usually go over and talk to them. I'll bring them cookies. Just like, it's okay, guys. You can stay in the class. It's all right.
Thank you.